We've all had choices since the day that we were born. And right now I'm choosing to not watch the 49er football game. I was watching America's Cup, which was pretty interesting, the racing in San Francisco Bay, and happened to click onto the channel, the football game. And then this commercial came on, and they showed this new video game with just these dragons and fire and swords and the extreme fast-paced violence, mayhem, fire, etc. It's like incredible. And they show these teenage kids just like totally digging this, loving it. You know, I said, that's it. You know, no football today. I'm not going to, my choice is, you know, I'm not going to watch anything that has these type of commercials come on at all. That's it. So, goodbye football. You know, you just lost a viewer. Hey, that's business. That's free enterprise. You raise the flag and see who salutes. You can't force anyone to salute. So, those are choices, and we all have choices we have to make. And those choices are consequential, actually, at this time. Very consequential. No question the squeeze is on now. There is no question. Very diabolical what is taking place on this planet. You know, the facts are that so far the Bible prophecy has turned out to be quite accurate. Just, see, I don't agree with the contemporary theology, Christian theology at all. In fact, it's completely upside down and backwards. However, the prophecy, it is more or less, it's really playing out the way that they, you know, wrote it. So I'm able to, you know, be wide enough context to not worry about, well, this contemporary Christians about saying that, you know, spirit became flesh, you know, nonsense. But the old prophecies in the Bible playing out in today's age were very, very much playing out the way that that they said they would. Which does mean, you know, it is true that even the wisest on this planet will be pulled down into the turmoil if not for intervention of the Holy Spirit. That is a fact. Because literally, you have to be perfect to be able to handle the situation now. And I just came across a situation today that illustrated that perfectly. I don't quite remember what it is right at this point. But I handled it right. I realized, the ego said, well, hey, you know, how do you know that you're right and I'm not? Only, he said, I'll listen to someone who's perfect. You know, in other words, the ego always has this out saying, well, I'm not unreasonable. I'd listen to someone that's perfect. But if you're not perfect, then how do I know you're not being unreasonable? So literally the ego presses to the point all the way to insisting that if you're not perfect, you've got no right to say anything. That is the situation we're in right now. So again, only a perfect savior, perfect guru, etc., is able to deal with these times. And since I'm not perfect, I'm not able to deal with these times. That's the message in the Bible. It's absolutely correct. Very, very helpful. Some of this stuff is extraordinary. Families being divided against themselves, all this kind of stuff, absolutely is true. Very evil time, absolutely is true. And so, if you are not perfect, you have to understand that the trap that's being laid is you will not be able to in any way counter what's going on. In any way. Because their goal is unabated, uninterrupted, seamless irrationality. Seamless irrationality. And so, and then they claim that they're not irrational. That you're irrational for asking them to listen to you because you're not perfect. See, that's the trap they're laying. But that statement itself is completely irrational, isn't it? So the trap that they're laying, let me lay this out for you so you see it, is their claim, they claim they're not irrational at all, And who are you? They say, are you perfectly perfect? And you say, no. And they say, well, it's very irrational for you to claim that I'm irrational if you're not perfect, because how do you know? So they said, and they say, well, I'm totally rational because I'll listen to someone who's perfect. That's rational, right? And I won't listen to anybody who's not perfect. And then they've got you there, right? You cannot, you feel like you're trapped with that. Now, of course, it's a totally irrational viewpoint. For one, there have been perfection. There's perfection within constantly, and they don't listen to that. So they don't listen to perfection. But, you know, you really cannot say, well, you know, they say, well, you're not rational, because you can't counter that argument very successfully at all, actually. And for them, they're able to justify and say, you're not perfect, therefore I don't have to listen to you. And I know, he said, but if there was someone perfect, of course I would listen to them. So I must be rational, and you must claim that I'm not, you must be wrong. And so then they push the whole agenda to up to that far. That's how far the high tide is gone. Is only someone who's absolutely flawlessly perfect will they claim that they'll pay any attention to whatsoever. But that too is a lie, because they won't pay attention to that either. They haven't. But you cannot counter that argument, because they'll say, well, are you perfect? Then I'm not listening to anything you say. What do you do? What do you do? What do you do? In other words, you have to be honest about your situation. So if you claim, yes, I am perfect, then they'll say, oh, really? Okay. And then they start playing with you, you know, looking for your weaknesses, etc. So it is truly boiled down to that. And they are clever beyond clever, very shrewd, very, very shrewd. And I'm experiencing this, have been, but it's getting very bold right now. The traps are being laid extraordinarily well. They have their icons, they have all this leverage that they've got, and the only leverage we have is to say, see you later. Auf Wiedersehen. We have that leverage. And that's the advice that's been given to us throughout the ages, as at some point you'll have to sidestep this world. Absolutely. That's just cosmic business as usual. It's not always possible to stay in a certain place, given certain events, etc., in that place. And there are times when relocation is necessary. And you have to have the humility to, you know, accept it. And, you know, don't underestimate the capacity of this irrationality. And you may think, oh, these people aren't so smart. Well, they're smart about their business. They know their business. The ego knows its business. Its business is insanity, but it certainly knows how to pursue insanity extraordinarily well. So it makes the right moves. It's making the right chess moves. There's no question about it. It's folly to say the ego is not fantastically successful at what it does. Within a certain time frame, if you start stretching out time, then you start saying, whoa, it's not really successful at all. But if you condense time down, it can seem that it's very, very successful. We say, give the devil its due. Very important. Don't underestimate it. So one way the Holy Spirit could stretching time, whatever we think has happened, it seems like utterly inconsequential in the stretch time sort of. Somehow the way the Holy Spirit plays with time, makes it all seem entirely inconsequential to us. It's a miracle. I mean, I cannot, explain it at this point exactly. It seems like a miracle, actually. How it's able to stretch time, work with time, to take all of the bitterness and the sting, and et cetera, out of existence and out of anything we've ever experienced, or think that we've experienced. It's some big time miracle. You see, the ego has to shrink time down, has to deal with time in a certain way to give the illusion of its success, of its power. So what the Holy Spirit does is give us a different way of looking at time. Very much so, a different way of looking at time. And this is a big dividing line. I mean, between the way that we look at time is all important. It's a perception, it's a point of view. The point of view we have. We can shift that point of view. You know, Carlos Castaneda and Don Juan said, shift your assemblage point. Maybe that has something to do with it. I don't know if that was a metaphor, or something actual or something, but, shift your assemblage point. Shift your point of view of time. So don't try to gain victory within a point of view that's been set for you, that the ego says, this is your point of view, see if you can win that. No, winning means shifting your point of view. That's what I mean, sidestep. Shift your point of view. Shift your point of view with time. And in doing so, that opens up relocation, actually. It opens up options. You have a completely different sense. You don't feel trapped anymore. It's just there's just a whole lot of capability and options that come into the picture once we're able to do that. So what we need is a perfect guru here, or the one within, to shift our point of view of time. And we should be able to locate one at this now. We should be able to locate one now. And how do you do that? Simple. Just sit. A glance, a look, a talk, a word. Just sit. It's going to happen for sure. If we're able to find a perfect teacher now, then the point of view is going to shift. It will shift. Otherwise, you won't go see them. you won't, no way. But if you're willing to have your point of view of time shift, then you just sit there and it will shift. And then you will, go from there. Because then that itself will open up a whole different way of seeing your situation, seeing the situation. It may look very different, very different. So don't try to solve the situation the way it appears to you. Work on changing the way the situation appears to you. So this is along with the lines of sidestepping it. Don't battle with the way the situation appears to you. We went to a 7-Eleven today, and someone I was with bought some lottery tickets, and something happened with the cashier, the one who works there, the owner of the store, and basically there was a comedy of errors that took place, and we were out $2. Okay, we tried to explain what happened. We tried to sort it out, and the cashier. No, from their point of view, we were never going to change their conclusion, which their conclusion was, I've got your money already. I'm not giving it back. It doesn't matter what you say. That's their point of view. And so I caught on to that. I was tipped off to this, and I said, okay. We don't have all day to sit here trying to shift your point of view, because it wasn't going to shift. He was not interested in shifting his point of view. So I said to my friends, I said, look, we're just going to leave. Thank you very much. Have a great day. Boom. Out the door. Gone. Yeah, we lost $2. Is it worth it to get involved in a terrible squabble over $2 and knowing you're not going to win? No, it's crazy. Should have seen it coming. Which I kind of did, but it wasn't me that was involved directly. So, again, don't battle the situation as it appears. What was the one thing that we needed to think about there? The option of simply leaving the store. As soon as you see that option, you say, wow, of course, it's easy. Problem solved. What's $2? No, forget it. It's two pieces of paper. You know, what good is that to you? What good is the world to you if it's burned up? You know, it's not going to be any good to you in time at all. So when we're valuing this world right now, okay, here's what I mean about expanding time. Your perception, different viewpoint. We're saying, oh, how valuable the world is. I got to get everything. I got money, power, prestige, position. I'm battling for it. I can't give this battle because there's so much value here. But if you expanded your perception of time, you would see this planet is going to be burned to a crisp very shortly, actually. So you would say, hey, there's nothing really here of value at all. I mean, do I really value something that is going to be completely gone very soon? In fact, all this stuff? No, that's crazy to keep battling for something that's so temporary. So then it makes it a lot easier to leave, right? You say, I lose the $2, you know, well, I'll make that back, you know, like that, and plus, you know, way, way more. It's a smart, you know, you have to be shrewd about that. So how valuable is a world that's going to come to an end? It's not very valuable. It's kind of like taking a drug. You know, how valuable is that? The experience is going to come to an end quite soon, and you'll feel lousy afterwards anyway. So, you know, how valuable is that? Not very valuable. So, from a different, you know, viewpoint, if you could see the future, know what's going to happen, you would probably make different decisions. And you'd stop battling with the world, battling with, you know, wow, what are we battling over? How ridiculous. You know, what are we battling over? Who rules the earth? Who calls it home? Who says, this is my dwelling place? These are my rules here. Yeah, but how long is that going to last? A very Pyrrhic victory. Stupid. Like Jesus said, he said, don't lay up your treasures in this world where the moss, you know, eat your clothes and the iron rusts and everything is corruption creeps into everything. He said, don't lay your treasures up here. Lay your treasures up in the, quote unquote, the world that is to come, which is the dwelling place that he has prepared for us. Lay your treasures up there. In other words, that's the place you want to value. Don't value this world, because he knows it's going to come to an end. This is the shifting of your sense of time. And of course, here's the problem. If we want to value the stuff we've got a hold of, we've got a lot of prestige and power, reputation, all the stuff we've got going for us. Do we really want to find out that it's going to be all gone very soon? No way. We'll say, no, I want to cling to the illusion. This is mine forever. This is mine forever. Of course, your body is going to pass away and then you won't have any of it anyway. So, those But people are scared to change their perspective on time. The thinking they have too much to lose. In my case, I don't really have anything to lose, so it doesn't really scare me. In fact, I welcome it. The very purpose of impermanence is to get witness to itself. It's the very purpose. It's a training program. So, of course, this world's impermanent. Everything in impermanence is impermanent. What are you thinking? That there's some permanence in impermanence? There's not. Even the Holy Spirit's dream is not permanent. But it can give the appearance, it gives the right appearance to nullify the continuity problem for us. But it's still impermanent. It won't last forever. But it has just the right touch to it that makes it solve the continuity problem for us. But again, the business of impermanence is impermanence. And so what are we, you know, struggling for here? We should be struggling to get the answer to the continuity problem. We should be working on that. Absolutely. What kind of legacy can you leave in impermanence? Nothing, really. No legacy. By a cemetery, Golden Gate National Cemetery, yesterday. You saw those headstones and it just made me sick. Just revolting. I can't stand it. The you know, the inhumanity. What's happened, you know, in this planet? It's just the play of impermanence is what's happened. And yet we're thinking we're on the verge of making this planet permanent. We're going to give it a finish its birth process, as all the New Agers like to say. Some of them. There are splits in the New Age thing too, absolutely. Some are talking about ascension, actually. But a lot of them are talking about the planet's ascending. And it's going to be, you know, impermanence is going to finally be born, become real. It's just the only problem is it hasn't completely solidified, been born yet. You know, you got Sri Aurobindo trying to combine the flesh and spirit into this new metamorphosis, a metanoia, and into this the final birth, the real birth, bringing spirit down to the world and birthing a new planet that's you know, a synthesis of the, you know, all this. Talk of New Age, talk of blah, blah, blah. You know. Cannot do it. So I came into the world at a time where all this stuff was all the rage. I came in at the beginning of the New Age. It just was taking off. And I said, folks, this is all nonsense. And they didn't like it. And so as persona non grata, really, you know, you had Teilhard de Chardin, Sri Aurobindo, the mother of Pondicherry, you know, and it went on and on and on and on and on about all these New Age gurus. And it just became this massive global movement, and it penetrated into the United Nations, the bureaucracy, the planet. So, oh, this planet, we think we're following this the birth of the New Age, the birth. We're giving birth to the age of Aquarius, or, you know, What are we giving? Are we changing impermanence? If not, then it's the same old impermanence. We haven't done anything. We can't change impermanence. Impermanence is impermanent. That in itself is impermanent because it will never be real, and reality will never be changed by it. And we are created of reality, and so reality is within us, and we don't want the impermanence. Impermanence will never succeed in making us prime creator, so eventually we'll give it up. So it's impermanent. Impermanence will be impermanent, but only because we set it down and say, this never worked, this will never work. No, it will never work. No chance of it ever working. No, we can't, this will never work. So, you know, I could not get through to the New Agers. I had a higher, you know, I had a higher reasoning capacity. I had the capacity to actually reason and see, you know, clearly. And said, "Is what you're doing cannot work. You're discarding facts and reason, and making up your own rules as you go along." You cannot transmute impermanence into permanence. You cannot make impermanence permanent. That's really what they're trying to say, is that, finally we've made this impermanence here permanent. Therefore, we should all be happy with it. In other words, impermanent foreverness about constant death, dying, etc. And they say, well, it's permanent, so you should have bliss. This is, again, complete level confusion. And they don't even, they're so caught up in their idealized images and idealized fantasies, etc., that they never take the time to check it out. It's hard work checking stuff out, fact-checking. Very tough work. It's very doable. What's tough about it is nobody cares. You know, you can fact-check it quick, but then you realize, you know, who do you share it with? Nobody. Nobody's interested in that. It gets in the way of your idealized images. What they're saying is, ideally, this is what I want. Therefore, this is how it's going to be. Make up your own truths. Make up your own facts. We say, hey, who's to stop us? We live in a new reality. Nobody can stop us from making up our own facts. How wonderful, how free we are. We can make up our own truths and our own facts. We can even make up that we die. We can even make up that everything gets destroyed. We can make up anything we want to, et cetera, et cetera. We think, look how free and powerful we are. We determine our own reality. That's the New Age talk. We determine our own reality. That's the New World religion, the ego's New World religion. We're the determiners of our own reality. And they don't even question it. And that's been marketed now here on this planet for so long that there's so many people who feel that's their true inheritance, that's their birthright, that we get to make up our own reality. So someone comes in and says, hey, no, the facts are set. We don't determine what's factual. The prime creator does. Prime creation is still exactly the same as ever been. We don't get to determine what's true and what's not. Prime creator's already set what is true and what's not. Then they look at you like, you're crazy. You know, you're absolutely crazy. What's the matter with you? You're just not with it. You're not hip enough. You just don't see the big picture. The big picture that we get to make up our own rules and own truths. No, you don't. But they've never been willing to entertain this at all. But just ignore it. Eventually, they just completely ignored it. I used to argue, discuss, argue, and they just completely ignore it. Just, you know, nothing to see here, move on. You know, the fact is we are the presence, eternal presence of being. That's a fact. You can't change that fact. We're invulnerable, that's a fact. We're endless, that's a fact. We're one. Reality's all one. That's a fact. The prime creator created all this. It's not spirit. That's a fact. Spirit cannot displace the prime creator. That's a fact. You cannot put... reality is not at the mercy of anything. That's a fact. Everything's set in reality. The rules, the laws of reality are set. That's a fact. See, all these things are incontrovertible facts. We can't change it at all. So what kind of freedom do we think we have when we're saying that we can make up our own reality? Like we're in charge of our reality. No, we're not. But, you know, it seems like you're dragging the party down when you say those things. Because all the New Agers have been having, man, we got this bliss party, man. We're blissing out. This is just, you know, are you kidding? It's love and light and peace and everything's incredible. We're going to just, you know, do all this stuff. Why? Because we want to. We're the ones who decide, you know, what's real and what's not, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And if they say, we got no continuity issue, no, we just decided that we don't have one, so it's not there. Well, good luck with that one. Because when you decide to drop all your idealized fantasies about you being, you know, the one who determines what's true and unreal, etc., there's the continuity problem. And you say, whoa. And then you mislabel it, saying, that's just a sign that God doesn't want me to drop all this stuff. See, God really, they say, oh, no, see, God wants me to keep going on with this freedom. I need to get with it even more. No, that's not true. It's the continuity problem you're feeling. It's kind of like going from one culture to another. And we think like, wow, you know, it's going to take a lot of adjustment to get used to this new culture. You know, not used to it. It's a continuity issue there. But it's like a total continuity issue between, you know, fantasies of the annihilation of reality and reality itself. You know, polar opposites, as it were. So to go from extreme familiarity with one to the other is, seems like a real, you know, real discontinuity there. So it's there. The discontinuity problem is there in everyone already. It's already there. Just to deny it is folly. It's the wrong use of denial, for sure. What you need to deny is the denial of the continuity problem. Stop denying that it's there. Say no to this denial, because it is there. And the sooner you recognize it's there, the sooner you will get to accepting the resolution of it. If you continuously spend your energy saying it's not there, you haven't spent any time at all getting ready to accept the resolution to it. No, you've gotten nowhere. And that's what I see in this world. People have gone nowhere. They haven't made any progress at all. In their minds, they've made incredible progress towards denying the continuity problem. But since that's impossible, it's not any real progress at all. Now that's what I mean about a perfect teacher. A perfect teacher knows what I'm telling you effortlessly. I don't. It's an effort for me. So that's the difference. That's the difference. I mean, I know the same that they know. But for them, it's effortless. For me, it's full of effort. So it's not the same. It's not the same. You have to instantly and effortlessly know all of this to be able to keep your sanity in this world at this time. It has to be instantly and effortlessly. You have to be perfect at it. No effort. Instantaneous. Seamless and instantaneous knowing. Yeah, you have to have that, or else you're not going to be able to handle this situation now. Because the craziness is so strong. But the topics that we're talking about here are the same topics that you would talk about with a perfect teacher. Only you wouldn't really have to talk about them so much, because you would get the direct transmission, which may frighten some people. They think, well, that's too fast. But all of these kind of topics are high level topics, for sure. So this is not some low level teaching. This is very advanced teaching. But again, it's not effortless. So that's a big difference. But at least you can feel in yourself, you know, that it's effort to get this, and realize it's not effortless for you. Again, people have gotten nowhere. And only a perfect teacher can accept that can handle the fact that all this effort has gotten absolutely nowhere. No progress at all. But by effortlessly seeing that, they're able to turn you around towards right effort. You see, but if there's some doubt, then the battle is over. Wait a minute, you're insisting I've made no effort. You're a liar, you're a deceiver, you know. People will seize upon that, thinking, again, that the denial of the continuity problem is the way to go. That's how people are functioning now. The denial of the continuity problem is the way to go. It's not. It's the acceptance of the continuity problem, that it's there, the recognition it's there, and then using your time and effort to align with the Holy Spirit and say, okay, Holy Spirit, I trust and accept that you have the resolution. I'm going to go that direction. That's the only way you make progress. Denying the continuity problem will never result in any progress whatsoever. You're still at a zero. You've not even started. Most people on the planet have not even started at all. But they have this delusion that they have, a very strong delusion. And they will be furious with you if you assert this. If they feel the slightest wiggle room, they will pounce. Their fury will pounce on you. But if you're a perfect teacher, you can effortlessly dismiss all this effortlessly and instantaneously and perfectly. They can't really pounce. They can't really pounce. They'll go, you know, and then go on their way, but they can't really pounce. There's nothing to pounce on. How can you pounce on certainty? Effortless, instantaneous certainty. No, they're incapable of pouncing on that. For me, they can definitely pounce on me. No question about it. I get pounced on all the time. Well, people are careful. They're kind of, you know, like a little wary. They're wary of me. They say, you know, he may fight back. If I pounce on him, he, you know, it may be may not turn out so good for me. So they're wary, but they absolutely can and do pounce on me. But with a real perfect certitude, no, they just say, forget it. I'm not going to win this one. No chance. You know, the ego is completely insane, but it's not stupid, as it were. It's still shrewd. And, you know, can recognize, I can't win this one right now. It's not now, so I'll wait till a later date when I can finally pounce, but not now. So this talk is going well. I'll just keep going. The sunlight's pouring in. The heat is up there. It's maybe a little less hot today, maybe 96, 97 or something. You see, there's no way you can be certain unless you've actually accepted the solution of the continuity problem and have it work for you and have it completely resolved. Only then can you be a perfect teacher, because you know it works and you know exactly what it's all about. But if you just know from a standpoint of reason that this is the way it must be, you still don't know for sure how it turns out, even though theoretically, you can say it must turn out. I know my reason, but that's not strong enough to someone who is determined to be irrational and use magical thinking and magical belief that denying the continuity problem is the answer. You're going to get in a dogfight. You know, they're going to battle it out, and you can't really win that battle lacking certitude. Because what will happen is, if you have perfect certitude, you will just laugh it off, and doesn't bother you in the slightest bit, you know. Whereas if you don't have perfect certitude, you feel like they're undermining you. You're being undermined, and you don't like it. You feel jittery. So there's this, you know, you're getting pulled into it. But certitude doesn't feel jittery at all. Those are the perfect gurus. No jitteriness there. And then people feel that, and they sense it and say, wow, I can't pounce until I see some sort of weakness, some sort of jitteriness there. It's unnerving to not see any jitteriness. So of course, if your purpose is to pounce on a perfect teacher, you're going to stay away from them. You're not going to enjoy it. Whereas the purpose is to help shift your point of view, how you view time, etc., then you'll say, oh, very welcome here, very welcome. So, It's hard to believe there's not a perfect teacher in the world somewhere. Someone with perfect certitude. There are those who do yet in this world. Not the true effortlessness of it. Instantaneous effortlessness with no thought at all. No effort or thought required. None. So how fast is that? It's faster than thought, isn't it? You see, the real gurus, the perfect gurus, are faster than thought because no thought's required. So we think, you see, those who are trying to deny the continuity problem believe that nothing's faster than thought. And so they can fight you with thought fighting thought. They can match you. But there is one thing faster than thought, and that's no thought. And the perfect gurus don't require any thought whatsoever for their position. None whatsoever. So they're faster. They're faster. They're already there. Wherever you try to go, they're already there. they're everywhere because there's no thought required. So how long does it take to be there if there's no thought required to be there? How long does it take? It doesn't take any time at all, actually. Whereas thought still takes an instant, right? There's still the element of time within thought. But with no thought, there's no element of time. So wherever you're going with thought, trying to get there, the guru's already there. Everlessly there. And so they already know. So, you know, you can't outrun them. How can you outrun the guru, you know, the perfect guru? How do you outrun them? They're already there. And they're not trying to be anywhere else. Jesus said, take no thought for the morrow, so to speak. Take no thought. You take no thought, you're already there. You're everywhere. How long does it take to be everywhere? Well, if you think about it, it could take a long time. If there's no thought involved, it's right now. So the trap that you get pulled into is all this fast thought that's going on and being intimidated by lightning quick thought. What you have to do is be able to be in no thought. But the no thought is not the suppression of thought. Okay, this is where we get into trouble. And I'll explain this to you. When we try to stop thinking by meditation, by various techniques to stop thinking, this isn't the way. The way is to have the continuity problem resolved for you. And once it's resolved, you don't have to give any thought about whether or not there is a resolution to the continuity problem at all. No thought is needed. That's very different than trying to suppress thought. Because when you try to suppress thought, there's still the thought of trying to suppress thought. You're still in time. You're still, you know, thinking about it. Whereas if you actually finish the continuity problem is resolved by the Holy Spirit, then you know. You don't need to give it any thought of whether it's resolvable or not. You know. You know. So you're already there. You're already there. That's the real state of no thought. So again, all this time spent trying to, you know, get into this no thought state or mode has been, you know, upside down and backwards. Because as long as a continuity problem is there, you're going to be thinking about how to solve it. No matter what, you can sit in a cave for however long you want to, trying to minimize your thoughts. Okay. But the continuity problem is still there. And so eventually you'll start thinking about why it's still there. And then there'll come back, then your thoughts will come right back. You get somebody in this condition, you know, of no thought. At least they think so. For a long, you know, whatever, they go into meditation, I have no thought, it's wonderful. And then they start thinking about, like, why is the continuity problem still there? And then they're right back to thinking, how do I get rid of it? They've really gone nowhere. Haven't gone anywhere. It's like a drug. It's like taking a drug. I really believe that trying to still your thoughts is like taking a drug. Because it has nothing to do with solving the continuity problem at all. It's still completely there. This gigantic problem is still there. And all you're doing is thinking, well, if I just still all my thoughts, maybe it'll disappear. Oh, it's still there? I better start thinking about that. That's a thought itself. Hey, it's still there. That's a thought. Gone is the pseudo no thought state. It's not stable. It's not stable. It's absolutely not stable. So the way to know thought is by knowing that the solution is there and it works. And then you're in a position of knowing. You're already there. But there's no trick to it. People go to the guru and say, what's your trick? What's the trick? How are you able to keep your thoughts away? There's no trick at all. I don't need to think about it. It's done. I don't need to think about how to do it. It's already been done. And I've experienced it, so I know it's already been done. So no need to think about how to do it. Because really what we call thoughts are all about how do we do this? It's really a question. They're really questions. What we call thoughts are really just questions. And we say, how do we do this? And the guru, perfect guru says, well, as far as getting rid of resolving the continuity problem, already been done. Been there, done that. The Holy Spirit does it. There's no more questions. And even when we try to change thoughts into the declarations, like, I'm going to do it this way, there's still the question of, is doing it this way going to work? That's still actually a question. So I would say all the thoughts that we have are really just questions. Questions. And I say that we're questing. We're on a quest. How do you end all these questions? By actually finding the remedy, accepting what actually works, and then that's the end of the quest. End of the quest. We're in a quantum time right now, so that's why I'm taping so much. It's just to try and keep treading water. We're in such an incredible time right now, really. We're getting it from all angles, really, from all angles. You know, who are the two most powerful people on the planet? President of the United States and the Pope, probably. And we're getting it from those two angles for sure. And from all other angles as well. Because who's using those people for their purposes and agendas, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it trickles everything. It just there's no angle that we're not getting it from, basically. You know, very, very few. Deny the continuity problem, you know, and the people say, we're home free. Just do charitable works, you know, just do the Pope says, just, hey, forget about all this, you know, theory and stuff. Just get out there and wash someone's feet and give them a meal and we'll call it good. What continuity problems? No continuity problem. What are you talking about? President, yes, we can. Just you know, we can make this world a utopia. There's no continuity problem. Let's just go full tilt, you know, into solving all the social problems. That's the problem. The problem is all this other stuff. So what happens? We displace the continuity issue onto all these other issues. And again, the fact is, if we, you know, accept the resolution of the continuity problem, there are no other problems. All the other problems will vanish. Because we realize we're not there. It's a dream. What are the problems of a dream to the dreamer that awakes from the dream and realizes there's no truth, there was never any validity to any of that stuff that happened in the dream? Where are their problems then? Gone. So we have a world that is determined to deny the continuity problem, which is really denying the Holy Spirit. It is denying the Holy Spirit is what is taking place in this world. And the Holy Spirit's all about theory, actually. Seeing, you have to see the big picture. It's all about theology. It's all about recognizing, you know, the root, the true, what is actually the issue, the continuity issue. It's all about that. And so that's all important. If you want to go give someone a meal, great. Hey, I pass out tomatoes to people on peppers and stuff. I say, here, free, here you go. It's on me. Enjoy. My pleasure. Fine. Give some money to beggars, sure. Do whatever you want to do to help others, absolutely. But your first priority is always the theology. It is always accepting the challenge and responsibility of responding to the Holy Spirit, which points out to you what the problem really is. That is the continuity problem. And you have to acknowledge that you have this problem. In other words, that's called repentance, acknowledging you have this continuity problem. You have to do that. You have to understand the theology of how things, you know, that we're spirit, not prime creator. We are, the prime creator created us, same essence, but we didn't create the prime creator. It's not reciprocal creation like that. We tried to overthrow the prime creator to be prime creator. This plunged us into this training program, and we're so accustomed to it now, we're afraid to let go of it. God created the Holy Spirit to use time in such a way as to free us from this continuity problem. And that's theology right there. And understanding all of that, then you can accept the remedy. Not understanding any of that, how can you accept the remedy? It won't fit your expectations at all. So how can anyone say, you know, forget about this nonsense of theology, you know, it's just a waste of time. How can that, you know, that leads right to denial of the Holy Spirit, actually. The ego has misemphasized the teachings of Jesus. Of course, Jesus said, you know, help, be charitable, be kind, be compassionate, be supportive. Of course, we all feel that way. It's not something that's difficult. But he said, you know, that has to be done in the higher context of your repentance, which is admitting you have this severe continuity problem, and then listening to the Holy Spirit on how that's resolved. It has to be done in that context. And what's happened is the ego has tried to inflate this, so you lose sight of the greater context. And you think, oh, I don't need to worry about any other stuff. I just, you know, if I just am, you know, give somebody some you know, some of my old expired stuff from the pantry, I'm getting to heaven, you know. Easy, you know, easy religion like that. When the ego inflates and deflates and gets all out of proportion and context. And then when you get somebody trying to fix that, you know, oh boy, you know, the ego says, who are you? You know, who are you to mess with the ego's distortions? Are you perfect? You know, it lays down the gauntlet. So it's a game of chicken with the ego, you know. It's a game of chicken. And the ego is perfectly happy to go drive off the cliff. It's going to go off the cliff, so don't play chicken with the ego. It's you know, sacrifices. It's game. We don't understand that the people who are trying to deny the continuity issue, they're willing to die for this. Because it seems like a lot easier if they just die in denial, die for denial. And then just imagine that they're going to be rewarded by the ego in some heaven. You know, that they believe the ego will reward them for dying for this, and they never have to deal with the continuity issue at all. Which, to them, it's a great deal. Because dealing with the continuity issue, struggling, it is really very unnerving and difficult. And it feels like you're on the edge. It's really tough. And so for most, they say, hey, the ego says if I just keep denying the continuity problem, do some charitable works, and I die, I'm in heaven. No more problem, no more continuity problem. It's been avoided entirely. And so they're willing to, you know, make that deal with the devil just because it seems so appealing. But of course, the devil breaks his promises. The ego breaks his promises. It has to. What else? It can't keep its promises. And then after enough times of having broken promises, finally you start saying, hey, wait a minute. You know, I don't trust you, the ego. I don't trust your deals anymore. People are willing to die, absolutely. So when you're reasoning with someone, trying to reach them, you're assuming that they don't want to die for their position, you know, that they don't want to die for no reason. If you just throw their life away, but that's a wrong assumption. So you're not dealing with rationality at all. You're dealing with someone who's convinced that by them refusing to repent, they're going to be saved. What do you do? Because they're going to wait for another lifetime and to find out whether what their position is true or not. You just have to wait. And then eventually they'll find out the ego broke its promise. And then they're going to say, wow, you know, maybe I need to pay attention to something else other than the ego. But until then, there's a game of chicken that they're willing to wait for another lifetime. So that's the situation in this world. You have so many, 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 many people who are willing to not only wait for another lifetime, they're willing to wait for another cycle. And again, that makes it very tough on us here. Very tough on us. Because we don't have that kind of patience and big picture for a whole other cycle. Okay, let's just wait for a whole other cycle. Whereas a perfect guru does. Perfect guru does. Even in a whole other cycle or two or whatever, however many, doesn't bother them. They're completely at peace with that. See, that's what we don't have. So we'll lose this game of chicken. We'll lose it. We'll lose it. No question. That's why we have to sidestep it. Bail out of the car. Sidestep it. Right now, that you know, they got the drop on us time-wise. Whereas a prophet would say, oh, you want to take, they don't even give any thought to it. It doesn't disturb them at all. And it's because of this that it doesn't disturb them at all that those who are threatening to take a million years, they start panicking and worrying, says, whoa, wait a minute. That's too much. Maybe I better take less, you know, because I'm playing a game with chicken that I can't win. You see, with the perfect guru, you play a game of chicken with him, you can't win. Because if you keep doubling down, like, well, I'll take 2 million years then, no problem. 4 million, you know. 16 million. On and on and on and on and on and on and on. 1 billion years. You know. I'll take 1 trillion years to do it. The perfect guru says, no problem, no thought for it. Oh, whatever, it's all fine. Then they start, you know, they can't win. They can't win that game of chicken. Whereas with us, they can win it. And they'll do it. If they get the sense they can win, they'll just keep doubling down. Just keep doubling down on it. And all the while, making you think that if you just let them win this game of chicken, then they'll start being nice to you and et cetera, et cetera. No, because you'll have no leverage over them at that point, none. And you'll be forced into teaching them. They'll say, we'll accept you as a teacher as long as you teach what we tell you to teach us, so that it'll take us this long, we can delay this long. And then, of course, you can't teach truth, because when to teach truth, you cannot delay that long. It's impossible. No way. No way. So you have to teach lies. Delay is only possible, especially long delay with lies. You know, when you start looking at the truth and accepting truth, then delay starts evaporating very rapidly. So you'd be a teacher of lies, you know, and so you definitely don't want that deal. And that's the deal that's being offered us. Because as soon as they win that game of chicken with you, they've got you. But a perfect guru, they cannot win that game of chicken with them. Cannot. And so then they either have to reject the guru altogether and say, you're not a teacher at all. Which then makes them look really foolish. And they're too nervous to do that. That's a big problem for them. So it becomes very problematical for them. And then they're able to start trying to say, okay, maybe less time. You know, and it gets ratcheted down automatically. Automatically. The guru doesn't have to really say or do anything. Just automatically they say, okay, maybe I'll do it in a couple lifetimes. Or maybe one cycle. No, how about a couple lifetimes? No, how about this one? And they keep thinking, well, I gotta do it fast, huh? You know, faster, I gotta do it quicker. And then that helps them. You know, they gradually get used to the expectations of using less time. That is all important. We have to change our expectations up in relation to time. Whereas we say, let's take less time to do it. But we only can decide to take less time to do it when we're unable to rattle the Holy Spirit, you know, by saying, we're going to take forever to do it. And the Holy Spirit says, it's fine, because I can make more time than forever, as it were. Not technically, but this figures of speech. Because in time, you can always assign a number. So it's never forever. Time is never forever. You know, there's always a number. You can measurement of it. So the Holy Spirit says, however you want to measure time, I can go beyond that measurement and have even greater amount of time. So you'll never win. And then when people realize they'll never win against the Holy Spirit, that's when they start saying, okay, that tactic will never work. So let me start then less time, less time, less time, less time. And then their expectations change. And the remedy needs to fit our expectations, absolutely. And eventually you say, hey, the continuity can be solved, problem can be solved right now, right now. And if you can't get past the Holy Spirit with time, then you realize, I've got a continuity problem. There's no question. I have a continuity problem. Because I can't win the battle of time with the Holy Spirit. So that means all the time that I have is a continuity issue with me. No question about it. I'm going to have to drop time. And how do I do that? So, if we don't, you know, size up the situation, we will be put in a role of teaching lies. And they say, hey, well, at least you're a teacher. I mean, isn't that what you wanted to be? No. I wanted to emphasize truth. Call it whatever you want, but witness to truth. They say, well, as long as you're teaching something, it doesn't really matter what you're teaching. In other words, help me delay and delay and delay and delay and delay forever. And only teaching lies will do that. So this has been another, you know, very intense session. Again, this is basically the area of coverage that you will run into with perfect gurus, except, again, you can't bluff them with time. They're already there. They have no thought about what works. They know it works. And therefore, they're able to deal with this massive push towards permanent irrationality. Whereas, and it's effortless for them, because there's no thought. We who still take thought about it are not in any position to play this game of chicken that's going on right now. There is a game of chicken going on right now. And it's basically the ego saying, well, we're willing to spend X amount of time in our position. Are you willing to spend that much time on your position? And then we start giving thought to that. And then, you know, we get pulled into time, as it were. And then we say, no, I'm not willing to give that much thought to it, that much time to it. Thought being questions. And then you feel like you're trapped. And then you feel like you need to make a deal. And of course the ego is willing to use as much time as it takes to bluff you, you know, out of your position. They'll say, well, you don't want to help me because you don't want to take the time. But the Holy Spirit will say, yeah, no problem. I got even more time. I got more time to help you than you have time to delay. So, no worries. And then that has a very completely profound effect on the situation. But we are not the Holy Spirit. We are not one who's had the continuity problem solved. So we can't win that game. It's unwinnable for us. And usually people are not willing to play that game of chicken all the way to a whole nother cycle. See, but what's psyching us out is the whole nother cycle thing. is there's people on this planet, too many people on this planet now, who are willing to go through an entire another cycle, a fourth dimensional cycle, and they'll do it. And that, you know, freaks us out. We cannot cope with the idea of trying to teach a fourth dimensional cycle at this point. Because in order to do that, you truly have to have that perfect leverage, or you cannot be outbluffed. Guaranteed. You know, ultimately the fourth dimensional cycle revolves back into third dimension, where you basically say, wow, I don't want to do that anymore. And I'm not going to bluff that anymore. I'm not going to bluff this long cycle type of thing. Forget it. And then you try to bluff the third dimensional cycle, and you say, ah, wow, that's too brutal. Forget that. So then you start listening to the Holy Spirit and say, okay, you know, you've got the goods on me, you know, and so no more bluffing. I'll listen to you. But because there's so many who are going to literally go into a fourth dimensional cycle, that we can't handle that. We can't handle it, you know, in our state right now. Cannot handle it. It's too horrible. Just like I could not handle all those gravestones at the National Cemetery. I couldn't handle it. Just like one gravestone for every year of a fourth dimensional cycle, you know. It just, I overwhelm me. And again, it'll overwhelm anybody who gives any thought to it. But the perfect gurus don't need to give any thought to that, these issues at all. So this is kind of, you know, it's not kind of, it's very high advanced teaching. And therefore, even if you understand it now, it seems like it'll fleet away like a shadow or something. You know, it's very, very easy to lose it, if possible. But on the other hand, at least you know it's there. You say, oh yeah, it's there, I know it's there. Well, I mean, I'll forget about it, once I finish taping, too. It's really, this is very advanced stuff. But very completely relevant. You see, in a long cycle, we're used to experiencing this feeling of struggle in trying to help. And the idea of struggling for such a long cycle, we cannot tolerate that. Cannot. No way. We'll get pulled into mutual exclusives. The attempt to teach, again, the demand that we teach to enable such a long cycle means we'd have to be teaching mutual exclusives, basically, right close to it, or close to it, which is hell, absolute hell for us. So there's no way. So in order to deal with the fourth dimensional cycle, you do have to be a perfect teacher, and you can't be bluffed at all, because you don't take any thought at all for it. And so you never feel any push towards mutual exclusives. And you just say, okay, when you want me to teach, that's fine. No worries. It's all easy, it's all grace, and the fourth dimensionals will like go, wow, I can't quite grasp this one. And then that'll get them going, like thinking, What is it that's beyond this, and how come I can't get it? And that'll speed up the cycle, as it were, and, you know, eliminate a whole bunch of time from it, actually. I mean, theoretically, the time is so great, it freaks us out. But from the standpoint of a perfect teacher, the time gets diminished greatly, simply because people feel that there's something that is greater than that cycle, and they cannot figure out what it is. And they try so hard to figure out what it is, the fourth dimensional cycle then becomes very problematical and upsetting to them. And then they don't want it so much. Because they say, we can't figure this out, you know, and we want to enjoy this cycle. And they're so stressed out because we can't figure out how can anything, you know, be greater than this. And they'll burn themselves out trying to figure it out. And with that burnout, they'll say, ah, I don't like this fourth dimensional cycle so much. And then they can drop back to a third. And they know that they don't like that real quickly. They figure that out quickly. And then they say, well, I don't like either of these. And then they get open up to, the way out of all this is to solve the, repent. The way out of this is to repent and say, yeah, I do have a continuity problem. Absolutely, of course. So one of the most effective prayers, contemplations, is simply to say, yeah, I do have a continuity problem, and just try to accept it. That's vast. Accept the vastness of your continuity problem. Way, way, way greater than you know. Than any of us know. But just kind of relax into that so you're no longer fighting against it. So what is happening now in the world is this great, great bluff going on of people saying we're gonna take a fourth dimensional cycle, and they're not really bluffing, they will. And you're gonna teach us the way we want to be taught. We're gonna get rid of any sort of reason or truth here. Try to get rid of it. We're gonna create a yes we can utopia. Etc., etc., etc. So I would suggest to simply spend some quiet time not thinking at all, except just accepting. Acceptance doesn't require much thought. Accepting, hey, I do have a continuity problem, and embrace that fact. Certainly, it's like a whole different feeling than you're used to. A whole different feeling than what you're used to. Usually we try to deny problems, pick them apart, psychoanalyze them, etc. No, no psychoanalysis required here. No denial required, just the opposite. We joyfully submit that we do have this massive continuity problem. I think this is what Christians say when they say I've come to Christ and admitted I'm a sinner. I think that's probably what they're experiencing. That for a moment, they're honest and say, I do have this incredible problem. It's a huge, huge problem. And then they get a sense of Jesus says, don't worry. Holy Spirit has already, resolved it. And then they get a sense that they're living in grace, that kind of thing. And that's genuine Christianity. That's real Christianity, not the stuff that, the other stuff. God becoming flesh, God sacrificing his only son so he didn't kill all of us, his wrath was appeased and all this, Jesus coming back to slaughter all his enemies and all this kind of, that's pagan Christianity. Real Christianity is to repent and say, hey, I've got this, Jesus, I got this incredible severe problem, I'm willing to admit to it. So we're taking this trip together there. Because I'm still in the process of that. I'm still in the process of doing that. Still working on that. Absolutely. The problem is with the way Christianity is now, is this sort of a hybrid sort of thing, mixed message thing. You think that somehow by admitting this, that then you have to then accept all this other nonsense. And it's not true at all. So we've had to kind of clear all this up, as it were, in order to get to the point where we can finally admit, yeah, we're going to have to accept all this egoic, you know, craziness. So. What people have been taught to do is admit they have little problems. We're not trying to admit we have a little problem, okay? We're not trying to admit that we, you know, snapped at somebody, got angry at somebody. Or we passed a beggar by. Or we told a lie, et cetera, all these little, you know, sins. No, we're working to admit that we have this vast problem that's even incomprehensible. It's so vast to us. In getting used to admitting this, confessing this, that's real confession. So what we're trying to do is real confession, which is real Christianity, actually. Which is why this channel is called Christ Clarity. Trying to clarify what Christ really intends for us. Real confession is to confess the vastness of the problem, even beyond our comprehension. Because it is. Continuity problem extends beyond our comprehension. Because we've been at this to such a great depth, to such a great extent, overlearned to such an enormous extent, etc. And the overall combination of all of this goes beyond what we can, with our time frame, goes beyond what we can comprehend, actually. So we have a sin, this continuity, a problem that goes beyond our comprehension, is so vast and tangled, etc., 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 really. And so we do need to work on this confession. And we're getting there. At least we know what we need to do now. That's the hard part, getting there. Then doing it is probably not so difficult. No thought required, it's just acceptance. We're no longer trying to define the boundaries of our problem, so we don't need thought, right? We're saying it's beyond the boundaries of what I can conceptually think about. It's greater than that, so I don't even need to try and establish what our boundaries are. I turn the boundaries over to the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit deal with the boundaries of it. It's beyond my comprehension, really. And it is. I mean, it's beyond the comprehension of thought. Because the more thought thinks about it, the more it keeps getting bigger. So, you can't really deal with it with thought. However you describe it, you just made it way, way bigger. So, don't bother describing the boundaries, defining the problem. It's a continuity issue. It's an unbounded sort of, for us, issue. Turn it all over to the Holy Spirit and say, it's all yours. We just accept it, that we have this incomprehensible, seemingly boundless for us, beyond our boundaries, problem. So there's not a lot of thinking taking place at all. You feel peaceful and quiet and centered and peaceful when you're able to take this step. And I believe there was a lot of real Christianity has been practiced throughout the ages, absolutely. Because I know that there are people who have received a lot of grace and there was this emphasis on admitting I am a complete sinner. I mean, was it Calvinism or whatever? So, I am a total sinner. I cannot of myself solve it because I can't even define how great the sinner I am. You know, there's a sense of total sin, meaning it's beyond our ability to define how severe the continuity problem is. That is accurate Christianity. Very much so. That has been around. It's been around. But of course it's under attack by those saying, no, it's not that bad, we can define it. Not true. It makes it worse. So there have been people throughout history where they did get into this confession mode. They did start to get the peace, and they may have gone far into that, you know. Yeah, saints even. There have been saints in Christianity, no doubt about it. Very much so. It all had to do with confession of sin. Absolutely. But they understood this, that I cannot even define my own sin, it's so great. That is true. That is very true. And how far away have we got from that? Because now we're in this mode of psychology can explain everything, which is the worst thing ever. It totally takes us away from true Christianity, true salvation, totally. The idea, no, I can work it down and define it and say, okay, I need to say this to you, and you need to react this way, but I want to forgive you for a reaction. What is that? No, we need two people together saying, you know what? Our sin is incomprehensible to us, boundless to us. We cannot define it in any way. And we accept that. We're willing to accept that and turn it over to the Holy Spirit. That is where it's at. That is where it's at. And we are so far away from that in the world right now as a culture, you know. It's hard to even talk about it, right? I mean, this is the first time I've really been even able to talk at this level. This is a high level of talking about it. But it shows you it's still there. And it's easy to talk about. Once you get the focus there, it's still there. It's still there. Christianity is still there. The way is still there. The confession of this, you know, incomprehensibly great sin is still there. And it's the sin of continuity problem, so to speak. It's the problem, you know, missing the mark. We can't get it right because of this continuity problem. That's what it's saying. All right, that's it. All right, very great. Then. I'm getting a call. Time to go, actually. Where am I going? To church. I think we just had church right here, didn't we? We certainly did. All right. Thanks for being here. That's it.